Ya at a Dineah Marie Peterson yinche twitzelni nishle to haglini bashishchi ashihandeshache kia ani deshanella. I introduce myself in my native language, and today I will be delivering the Lawrence University land acknowledgement. Lawrence University's Appleton and Door County campuses are located on the ancestral homelands of the Menominee Nation. Currently, there are 11 federally recognized Native American sovereign nations in Wisconsin. We acknowledge these indigenous communities who have stewarded this land throughout the generations and pay respect to their elders, past and present. Ahiyaha.
Thank you to Ami Hatori for today's prelude and Courtney Wilmington, Samara Morris, Jack Murphy, David Womack, Nick Muellner, Alyssa Kuss, Jack Benedict, Ali Goldman, Carson Bell, Rowan Bruckman, Ali Ramondi, and Daniel Green for the postlude. Your selections fit today's convocation perfectly. It is our custom at public events to read our land acknowledgement that joins hundreds of organizations in this country and around the globe, and that acknowledges peoples who came before us. Thank you to Dineah Peterson for reading the land acknowledgement. Traditions embody so much power these days during the pandemic. Thank you for gathering with us as a community as we celebrate academic excellence and leadership exhibited by students, faculty, and staff this academic year, both on campus and through distance learning. Yesterday, we notified winners and celebrated their accomplishments of 118 students and 5 faculty and staff. These awards span the entire university experience, from academic honors in the college and conservatory to student life and athletics leadership. The following faculty and staff have received awards this year. The Babcock Award for outstanding service to students and voted on by students to Kate Zaromsky, Associate Dean of Academic Success. The Faculty Convocation Award to Megan Pickett, our speaker today, Associate Professor of Physics. The Mortarboard Honorary Award to Linda Morgan Clement, the Julie Esch Hervis Dean of Spiritual and Religious Life. The University Award for Excellence in Advising to Chloe Armstrong, Assistant Professor of Philosophy. And Freshman Studies Teaching Award to Allison Fleshman, Associate Professor of Chemistry. You can find a list of this year's honors and award recipients at go.lawrence.edu/honors21. Today, we have the opportunity to acknowledge these outstanding members of the Lawrence community, as well as students elected to Mortarboard, the Senior Honor Society, Pi Kappa Lambda, Music Honor Society, and Phi Beta Kappa, the most prestigious academic honor society for seniors. Students will be elected to Lambda Sigma, the Sophomore Honor Society, in the next few weeks. The collective leadership of these students, faculty, and staff have enriched our university community, especially during this difficult year. Please join me in congratulating these honorees. Thank you for your leadership and your accomplishments. I also want to take this opportunity, my last to preside over honors convocation, to thank all members of our campus community who have worked collectively and individually to persevere during this very difficult year. Your fortitude and forward energy have inspired me every day.
Once again, congratulations to all honors and award recipients. Here's to y'all. Go team. My name is Allison Fleshman. I'm an associate professor of chemistry. And I want to read to you a quote from a friend of mine's Facebook post that I saw a few days ago. Actually, it was a few weeks ago. Quote, "One of the absolute best parts of this job is the reaction of a student who looks through a telescope for the first time. It's often a mixture of giddiness and childlike awe, followed by a ton of questions. This, capital T-H-I-S, this is why I teach astronomy and love to do public events. And it reminds me of how I breathlessly looked into the eyepiece of my first telescope. Megan Pickett's journey to the stars began at that telescope, which took her to New York and Cornell University, receiving her Bachelor's of Arts in Physics, When she was then she received her master's and PhD in astrophysics from Indiana University. She's worked at NASA's Ames Research Center in California and earned tenure at Purdue University before joining the Lawrence faculty in 2006. She's published over 25 research articles from the origin of the solar system to star formation and many things in between, and that's a pretty wide scale. I have had the pleasure of working closely with Meg and many other science faculty and Lawrence staff over the last few years through our Howard Hughes Medical Institute grant for inclusive excellence, which strives to create a more inclusive classroom in our introductory science courses. Meg's dedication to helping her students has been inspiring to me. I have learned so much from our conversations and am grateful for her mentorship, which I have requested periodically. She works hard to bring the wonder of science to the hands of her students and give them the opportunity to take that first look in a telescope, to incite the giddiness and childlike awe that inspired her own scientific path. But her activism for science doesn't stop with her students. In today's convocation address, The Stars, Mansions Made by Nature's Hand, we'll hear a call to arms against light pollution that is drowning our stars and perhaps our creativity and destroying what connects us to the cosmos. To protect the night sky, Meg will don her teaching hat and guide us to save the stars and future first telescope moments that bring about that childlike awe. Thank you, Meg, for all the work that you do. So now, it is my absolute honor and privilege to introduce to you Associate Professor of Physics and all-around badass, Dr. Megan Pickett.
Well, thank you, Allison, for that lovely and gracious introduction. And I want to also express my heartfelt congratulations to all of our honorees, and in fact, the entire Lawrence community. We have met the challenge of an extraordinary and hopefully singular year the way I knew you would. I am proud, you should be proud of what we have faced together and what lies ahead. And I cannot wait until we can be together on these happy occasions. But for now, again, I'd like to say good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Thank you for joining me in this convocation on preserving and protecting one of the most precious natural resources that we all share, that is the night sky. But before we begin, I'd like you to imagine that it's 2,000 years ago, and you are in a canoe in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. A few members are on your boat. It's the middle of the night. You are surrounded by the blackness of the night and the vastness of the Pacific Ocean with nothing along the horizon. All you have on this moonless night are thousands of stars and the backbone of the sky, the Milky Way, to guide you. Partly because you want to pass the time, and partly because as an apprentice, you learned this song. You start singing. You sing a song of stars and star lines that point your way to your new home, a home over the horizon that you've never been to and never have seen. You use the stars in this song as a compass to guide you, and you will teach that to your new apprentice. 1,500 years later, you're an Ojibwe child at a winter camp. You're helping your parents pack the winter camp for a move, and you ask your parents, why are we moving? Why are we moving from this place of comfort and safety where we have had food? And your parents tell you that, pointing at the sky, when the underwater panther rises in the east with his curled tail hanging in the sky, his face facing the great winter maker off to the west, they know that it's time that the ice is too thin to walk on, that it's time to move from the winter camp to the sugar bush camp. And in gratitude for the guidance and the reminder, you leave tobacco offerings for the underwater panther in the sky. In 1889, you are a tortured and brilliant artist. And from your room in Saint-Rémy, you look out a window and you see the morning star, Venus. And it so entrances you that you stare out that window, despite your despair, for hours waiting for the sunlight to come. And then you create one of the most iconic and beloved depictions of the night sky. And then it's 1977, and you're in West Bloomfield, just north of Detroit, and you're a 12-year-old child who is uncharacteristically sick home from school, despite the fact that you would love to be in your math and science classes. Your parents have told you that for the next 2 weeks, you are homebound. As a small comfort, your brother Galen hands you a book from the library. It's a book by H.A. Rey, one of the authors of Curious George. And that book is a key that opens the night sky for the very first time, and perhaps far too soon before you were ready. You rush outside after reading that book, and you stand in the early winter snow, ankle deep, and for the first time you see Orion and Taurus and Gemini and Eureka. You see the stars, and in tears you tell your father, "Daddy, I can see the stars." And the moment you know that you're going to be an astronomer, what you don't know, of course, is that you will go to Cornell, to Indiana University, work for NASA, and finally land at this wonderful institution with these wonderful students and peers, and one day be on a stage talking about the thing that you love most in nature, that is the night sky. We all have a connection to the night sky, whether we're astronomers or not. In my astronomy class this term, I asked my students, "Can you think of a time that is special to you about the night sky?" And more often than not, students, and I'm sure you could too, thought of and shared moments with family, moments with friends, up north, in the mountains, in the west, in the deserts. And an almost spiritual awe, somewhere between wonder and terror at the bewildering number of stars in the night sky, far too many to even count or make sense of. And in those stars, we as humans, ever since there were humans, have placed our hopes, our heritage, and our future. We reach to the stars because we are not permanent beings, and so we place things of importance, our gods and our heroes, our villains, important places, important people, into the stars as a way to give them permanence. And in return, they guide us, they tell our time, they tell us when seasons start before they even start, and they inspire us as artists and writers, and they compel us as scientists. And that's what I'm here to talk about tonight. It's the night sky and what it means to so many people and what we're losing one star at a time. But you are right to ask, if you're asking, where do we start? The sky is, when you're in a dark sky, bewildering. You can see 5,000 stars on a clear night. That's a bit much. My father used to tell me that he would never get lost because wherever he looked, he could find a Big Dipper, seven Big Dippers in the night sky, no problem. That's a joke, so we'll just add some laughter in post. I have an answer for you on where to start, and perhaps it's no surprise that I would recommend you start with a book, and in particular, H.A. Rey's book that I mentioned earlier. H.A. Rey again, one of the authors of Curious George, loved the night sky. And in 1950, he set out to write a revolutionary book. A book because he was frustrated that he couldn't see the night sky, he couldn't find constellations to save his life. And if you look at a star map, you might be forgiven if you're upset at astronomers for looking at these lines and thinking, why on earth? How does that image look like to people? Most of these drawings look like spaghetti thrown on the wall. H.A. Ray felt no differently than you do, or that I did. What he did was come at the problem like a child, in the best possible way. He erased the lines of the classical constellations, the constellations that were determined by the International Astronomical Union in 1922. And he realized that constellations was just a huge game of connect the dots. And there's no reason why you can't connect the dots in a way that's different from the way the IAU did. And that's what he did. And the result you can see looks somewhat what the constellations look like, at least the accepted IAU Western European versions of these constellations. So let me take you back to that winter night in 1977. When I went outside and saw the stars, Orion, among others, and you might, if you were to go out in a few months, see Orion if you lived in a place like Appleton, see Orion, you might see the winter triangle, the three brightest stars, starting at Orion's shoulder and moving to the left of your screen. And if you move to a darker sky site, you would see so much more. You would begin to see the fuzzy lane of the Milky Way galaxy, our home galaxy of hundreds of billions of stars, many of them just like our sun, many of them with planets around them, some of them with planets like the Earth. And if you were to take these lines that H.A. Ray created, suddenly the pictures come into focus. All of a sudden, the night sky talks to you, and you can see. Orion, of course, is Orion and everyone's favorite because it kind of looks like what it's supposed to look like as far as its usual description. But now you can see Gemini. You can see Taurus the bull. A little bit odd-shaped, but it's a bull. You can even see Monoceros, the unicorn, just to the left and east of Orion, this one horn. You can see my favorite constellation, one of my favorite constellations, Lepus, the hare, at Orion's feet. That's right, there's a bunny in the sky. And if the conditions are right and the sky is dark, you can see it. Now, you can learn a lot by looking at these constellations. But what I want to do now is focus on one in particular, and focus on Orion, and what we can learn from a single constellation and by looking at its history. The constellations that I have so far talked about are part of the 88 modern constellations that the International Astronomical Union has agreed upon. This is a group of astronomers that are responsible for naming all the naming conventions that we use in astronomy, from features on planets to the names of dwarf planets themselves. And in 1922, they met and decided on what we now have as the modern configuration of constellations. There are 88 of them, and because this was mostly a Western European group, the constellations are mostly Western European. In fact, the constellation names that you are familiar with come from Greek and Roman mythology, that is, they have Greek and Latin origins. The stars, though, on the other hand, are more often than not Arabic in nature, at least in transliteration. Orion is lovely because its main stars are bright enough that you can see it in almost any conditions, and its main stars are so bright that they all have wonderful names. You have to get to the faint stars like Pi Orionis, the six stars that make up Orion, before you get to the point where obviously astronomers ran out of imagination and went with a kind of a boring name. Although, if you think that's an exciting name, call me, I've got an occupation for you. But we have these stars that we're familiar with. We know Betelgeuse, right? And you may have heard of Rigel. But then there's also Saif and Bellatrix, the Amazon star. And then the three belt stars, Alnitak, Alnanak, and Mintaka. But surely more people saw these stars than Persian astronomers. Persian astronomers are responsible for these star names because after the fall of Rome, material like the Almagest and the classical depiction of constellations moved eastward. Persian astronomers took that information, they had their own wonderful astronomical traditions and expanded on it and excelled in astronomy. And then that information slowly moved back westward. So we have this combination of Roman and Greek constellations and Arabic constellation names, but not quite. A lot of these names are, as I said, transliterations or translations that are a little bit off. Betelgeuse, for example, comes from Betel Yaza. And but for, it's not really a typo, it's more of a write-o when a monk does it with a pen. We would call this Yetelgeuse. A misprint of a Y changed that to a B. Saif is Saif al-Jabbar, the sword of the giant. Rigel, the foot of the giant, is actually a contraction of Rigel Jaza al-Yusar. Bellatrix is still Bellatrix. These stars have their names from the Arabic traditions, but there are other names for these stars, and they serve as a wonderful reminder that everyone looks at the sky. If we focus on just the belt and the sword, there are dozens, at least, of traditions that look at the belt and the sword. And probably with respect to the belt, it's because when you see three bright stars in a straight line, you pay attention to that. We're good at recognizing patterns. And so the belt stars have been known variously as the three kings, or the three sisters. In southern Africa, they were the three zebras, and the sword of Orion was an arrow aimed at the zebras. What this is all telling us is that there are traditions that we don't talk about in astronomy, not often enough. And if we have those traditions with the stars, then surely we have them with the constellations as well. I mentioned earlier the story of the Ojibwe underwater panther, who is east of the Great Wintermaker. The Great Wintermaker is the Ojibwe version of Orion, although you can see that it extends out to Taurus to the right and east and over to Procyon to the left and eastward. Now, I would love to tell you about the importance of the Wintermaker and the stories associated with this incredibly important constellation, but it's inappropriate and not done unless it's winter. These stars carry significance, significant cultural meaning. To the Lakota, the same group of stars represented a buffalo hide. The three belt stars were the spine of the buffalo hide, the hand in the front. Gemini, to us, or to me, the twins, to the north and left of Orion, is the bear's den. In Belarus, they have their own heritage, celestial heritage, that is primarily a heritage of Christian iconography. And there, Orion is the celestial throne. And you could go on. But you should also ask, these are all Northern Hemisphere constellations. What if you live below the equator? If you live below the equator, or if you live south of the equator, then Orion appears upside down compared to the way I see Orion at 44 degrees north latitude. It's always good to change your perspective. And so for the Tupi people in Brazil, Orion was at the foot of a much larger constellation, the Wounded Man, wounded for his infidelity. His wife chopped off one of his legs, and the person in the foreground is actually trying to mimic the shape of the constellation that uses Orion as the bottom, Taurus for the head, and the Pleiades as part of the headdress. It was pondering these constellations and the stories behind them and the stories of the stars behind them that we rarely hear that made me think about kind of a crazy project for the astronomy class that I'm teaching this year. And that is the Lawrence, the first of, I hope, many years of the Lawrence University Celestial Heritage Project. I asked my astronomy students to pick a constellation, and if they didn't know a constellation, most people don't, they were given one, and they were to investigate that constellation from the perspective of another culture, other than Western European, other than the IAU official modern 88 constellations. And if they had a personal connection, if they had a heritage that is often not celebrated in our culture here, to explore that. And as always, my students never disappoint me. The breadth, the depth, the excitement with which they met this project was exhilarating. At the end of 4 weeks, they all gave presentations on constellations that range from Japanese, Chinese cultures, Vedic astronomy, Mayan astronomy. You see the Cayman Mayan constellation, which is a large constellation that starts with the spring constellation of Corvus the Crow and whose tail ends with the Big Dipper. You also see the Navajo first slender one, which is their version of Orion, and a cuneiform Sumerian star chart, along with many others. This was so exciting, and so exciting that now my class and I go out whenever it's clear to look through the telescope, but also to look at the sky and see these stars. See them from the Western perspective, see them from all of the other perspectives that we've looked at. And so if you were to go out tonight, and I encourage you to do so, if it's clear where you are, go out tonight. Go out tonight at midnight and face south, and then look up. And what do you see? Well, if you live in Appleton or near Appleton, this is something of what you'll see. You'll see haze on the ground because you live in or near a city, and you'll see a few stars. You'll see the faint outline of Scorpius. And right next to Scorpius, to the left, Sagittarius, just barely. You might see off to the northeast, Altair, the brightest star in the constellation Aquila, the eagle. But what if you were to go somewhere else? All it takes is 30 minutes. Drive 30 minutes west if you can. If you can get away from the city lights, you can go out on a moonless night. Suddenly, thousands of stars appear. Suddenly, you see the band of our own Milky Way galaxy appear. It is brightest and largest near Sagittarius and Scorpius. That's where the center of our galaxy is. You can now see the clear outline of Scorpius. You can see why so many cultures call that constellation Scorpius. You can see Sagittarius next to it, holding Scorpius in place with the bow pointed at it to make sure it doesn't get into any mischief. Although, to my eye, it looks like a teapot. You can see many more of these constellations, and if we were to superimpose on them the characteristic pictures that you would expect from Western astronomy. Things come more into focus. In fact, you see one of my other favorite constellations, though perhaps for the wrong reasons, between Sagittarius and Scorpius, one of the largest constellations in the sky is Ophiuchus, the snake handler, the doctor. Ophiuchus is interesting because his foot sticks down between Scorpius and Sagittarius. Why is that important? Well, the path that the sun appears to make across the sky, as my astronomy students can tell you, is called the ecliptic. And the constellations in Western astronomy that it runs through is called the zodiac. It's from that that we derive horoscopes in astrology. The less said about both, the better my heartburn would be. But the foot of Ophiuchus actually comes into the zodiac. And so technically, if you were born between November 15th and November 30th, you're an Ophiuchan. You're welcome. But sadly, because astrologers are a superstitious bunch, that would have made 13 astrological symbols. And so for their own reasons, they removed Ophiuchus from their zodiac. This would break my heart if astrology meant anything. But that's Western astronomy. What about other cultures? What did my students find in that? Well, in Korean astronomy, there are 400 constellations. Many of them are combinations of two stars or three. And they mark important people, important places. Again, it's a human instinct to place impermanence, things that are important to us in this all too short life. In Japanese astronomy, we have 28 houses of the moon, 28 stations of the moon. The moon takes about 30 days to move across the sky, a little bit less. And so it's natural that some cultures would actually mark the position of the moon every day by a particular constellation as it moves across the sky, rather than concerning themselves with sun signs. These are moon signs. On this same night, I suggest you, when you're done looking south, look east and up. And what do you see? Rising in the east, you'll see not too much if you are in a city. In astronomy, we often parcel out our constellations by season. Winter and summer constellations are often the brightest. That's because in the winter and the summer, we are looking through the plane of our galaxy where the stars are the richest. Fall, which would be rising in the east, and spring, which is now setting in the west, have fewer bright stars. That's because we're looking outside the plane of our galaxy. If you want to study galaxies, you do your observations in the fall and the spring. If you like star formation, like me, you do your work in the winter and the summer. But again, if you look to the east, there's not a lot there. So go ahead. Drive 30 minutes west from Appleton. Drive 30 minutes away, if you can, from where you are, if you're in a city, to see what you can see. Again, you see the Milky Way. You see the summer triangle in its glory, Vega, the highest and brightest star in the summer sky, Deneb, the brightest star in Cygnus, the swan or the northern cross, and Altair in Aquila, the eagle. But you see other stars and other constellations. We see, for the first time, fall constellations moving up. Pegasus, one of my favorite constellations, is rising now at about midnight. Pegasus is, of course, a winged horse from Greek and Roman mythology, and as much as you want that to look so special, the main stars of Pegasus form a square. It's called the Square of Pegasus. So it's supposed to be a winged horse, but it looks like Colorado. Again, you have to use your imagination in astronomy. You could also see Delphinus just south of the Summer Triangle. Delphinus is one of my favorites because it's tiny, it's cute, and it's one of two constellations that is tied to a Christian iconography. Cygnus the Swan is also the Northern Cross. Delphinus the Dolphin is also the brightest four stars are called Job's Coffin. And I think that's just wonderful. The more culture in the sky, the better. What about the other traditions? Well, if we go back to the Ojibwe, instead of a swan moving off, flying off to the right, we have the crane with legs tucked in close to each other, flying to the left. And instead of a poorly conceived Pegasus rising, we have an oppositely faced moose climbing the sky in the fall. The Lakota saw a box turtle and a salamander and the firebird in these same spots. Now I could go on, and I've been known to go on. I would be happy to take you through a tour of the night sky for every season and for every hour. But as you might have guessed from the outline of the talk and from some of the comments that Allison made, the first half of the talk is a celebration of what is in the sky. What we need to consider now is that all of this is in danger. This is a view taken actually about a decade ago of the nighttime of the Earth. So it's a photo mosaic, taking a look at the night of the Earth and collecting it in one view. And in it, you can see very clearly the eastern seaboard in the Midwest of the United States, as well as California. You can see the outline of the Great Lakes. You can see all of Western Europe, the British Isles and Ireland. You can see India, Japan, parts of China, Australia, South Africa. These are places in which extraneous light is taking away our shared heritage of the night sky. In fact, light pollution is an increasingly important problem for astronomers. On a clear night, you can see 5,000 stars. An unbelievable amount, and a beautiful amount. If you've ever been to a dark sky site, and I have, even as an astronomer, I've only been to a truly dark sky site like this a couple of times in my life when I have been observing. You have seen and felt the purpley black night between the brilliant stars that have their own special glow, that it feels like you could almost read by the Milky Way. But if you live anywhere else, if you live in the suburbs, you see only 500. And if you live in a city, if you live here in Appleton, the Fox Valley, if you live in New York or Chicago, San Francisco, London, you see 50 if you're lucky, and probably only 10. We're losing our sky. And this issue is called light pollution. It affects so much of what we do. And there are ways that we can combat it. We have to deal with increasing threats to the sky from places we wouldn't expect. But there are costs to the night sky leaving us, right? You should well ask, so what, right? The night sky is nice, but at what cost do we keep the night sky? How important is it as a resource? Well, I would argue it's a fundamental resource, but it also is important in so many other aspects of our lives and the lives of the planet. It affects animals, clearly. Anybody who has been around a light at night has seen the predation on insects. They may not have seen the predation on it. They've seen insects hovering around the lights. But that makes them more likely to be eaten. Our famous river flies were with us again for yet another season, are attracted to these lights. And while that is good news for the things that eat them, it means that it's bad news for them that have less opportunity to reproduce and then contribute to their own part of the food chain in the river. Moths that are important pollinators are over-predated. In fact, all prey species that depend on night to hide from prey are at risk. Migration patterns have been disrupted because of the amount of light that has been put out into the night sky. But it's not just animals, it's us. We have spent, many of us, the last year and a half staring at computer screens. So I don't have to tell you how much that hurts your eyes. It certainly hurts mine. Extension of light, especially blue wavelength light, bright blue wavelength light, is harmful. It creates glare, it disrupts our circadian rhythms, prevents or hinders the production of melatonin. It leads to sleep problems. Those of you who remember those blue blocker commercials from the 80s, turns out they were onto something, right? We didn't evolve to live under these conditions of constant light. We also have energy concerns. That's perhaps the thing that's easiest to wrap your head around. In the United States, according to the National Dark Sky Association, we spend $3 billion on light that does nothing except disrupt our sleep, kill our animals, and take away our stars. It's light that goes nowhere where it's supposed to be, is harmful, and yet we feel we need to do this. Taking away light from the sky affects our heritage as well. In Zaimont, you can no longer see the Milky Way. Where Van Gogh looked through his window to paint a depiction of the starry night, there's no starry night for him to paint. And we're losing that everywhere. The stars and the night sky should not be the province of only the people who can travel to very dark places. They're everyone's. And then finally, there's the issue of safety. This is a tricky one, right? Astronomers want to be safe. Astronomers want to have streetlights. Contrary to our reputation, we're not all night-living vampires. We get it. But there are ways to light for safety, and there are ways to light for safety that are wasteful. More often than not, our tendency is to overlight, is to use these bright lights that are not shielded, to light buildings in which no one is around, to have street lights, walkway lights that are on when no one is there, to have house lights that are on when no one is there. Those of us of a certain age can remember Jimmy Carter talking to us from the fireside in a sweater, telling us to turn down the thermostat and turn off the lights when you're not in the room. Turns out he was right. Maybe for a different thing, but he was right. There's one other threat I feel worth mentioning, and that's from the egomaniacal wannabe James Bond villain, Elon Musk, and others, who are constantly launching satellites into the night sky. This is a view, an attempted view of Comet West with dozens of Starlink satellites. Musk and others have launched thousands of these satellites in low Earth orbits, which means that they cross the sky, ruining astronomy. They have no awareness of where observatories are or dark sky sites are. And while it's kind of cool to see a string of satellites move across the sky, it adds to the glow and the problem that is already there. And it doesn't have to be that way. So, this is a problem. And I like to think that problems are not terrible. Problems represent opportunities. And maybe it's the NASA in me that wants to say this is not our Apollo 1 moment, this is our Apollo 13 moment. There are things that we can do as individuals and as communities to bring back our night, to have everything that we want, safe communities, energy savings, and a cultural heritage that is forever pinned to the sky above us. A group that has been spearheading this is the International Dark Sky Association. And I encourage you to look them up on the web. They have a number of suggestions that can help and have helped with this problem for decades. And they have suggestions that can help people on the personal level, in a household, in community, what you can do in municipalities. And they study the problems and point out things that perhaps we weren't aware of. So for example, I mentioned before that one solution for a number of years of energy cost savings has been to switch from high pressure sodium lights, which were very bad for the night sky, to low pressure, or no pressure, LED lights that were bright for less money. And that seems like a really great solution. The problem is that these LED lights often are extremely blue, high temperatures, what an astronomer would call it. You can get, though, lower temperature LED lights, as shown on the bottom. You can see the contrast between the two kinds of lighting systems. Above, you see the high temperature blue lights that accentuate the glare on the ground, especially in winter. It makes it dangerous for drivers, dangerous for pedestrians, and you are not going to see the night sky in a neighborhood like that. But replace the same lights with LED lights that are lower temperature, yellower, and suddenly the night sky appears even with the lights on. This is efficient light. These are street lights that are shielded, not just empty bare bulbs, and they put the light where they're needed. Similarly, there has been a profusion, happily, of lit outdoor resources, mostly for children, for sports. And we have a choice when we do that. Do we light those venues with big spotlights that then bounce off the grass, bounce off the parking lot, and bounce off into the surrounding suburb and the community? Or are we smart about this? Do we construct, as the image shows, street lights that are focused on the soccer pitch, that are lower temperature in color, that completely and adequately, efficiently light the pitch, but then if you want to get away, you can. The night is still there waiting for you. There are other things that the IDA does and studies. The use of light in cities has been shown to have unexpected consequences. Municipalities will light over light minority areas more with big spotlights. We're taking away the night in a very insidious fashion. What can you do individually, apart from talking to your municipal leaders? Well, you can certainly look around the house and look at your lights. You can look around your community and look at your lights. You can also join an effort called the Globe at Night. This is a citizen scientist project, my favorite kind. You get to be a scientist. You don't have to spend all the time I spent going to school. You can do something to help us. And if you go to this website, what it asks you to do is just go outside. It'll take your GPS coordinates. You can even get an app for your phone. And it'll ask you, what stars can you see? and it'll measure the sky brightness down to a particular magnitude star. The magnitude system, as my students know, and I apologize on behalf of all astronomers, is the standard way that we measure brightness of stars. The higher the number, the dimmer the object. Okay, so this dates back about 2,000 years ago to ancient Greece. So in my neighborhood, which I'm starting with here, I can see down to, and I'm off, kind of far away from, not too far away from Lawrence and Nina. I can see down to about 4.5. That is, I can see a good chunk of the sky. It's not great, but it's not horrible. On the other hand, in my observing site here on campus, just outside by Briggs where the rabbit statues are, just outside my office, this same measurement gets us to magnitude 2. That means that routinely, I can't even see the entirety of the Big Dipper. Now, I say this not to shame anyone. Everyone has a right to start from a position of not knowing what the problem is and then finding out what the solution is. But we should realize that part of the solution is collecting this data. And that's exactly what the IDA has done. As part of this citizen effort, the IDA has been able to identify, save, protect, and preserve dark sky locations internationally. This is a map of these dark sky preserves. You can go there and see down to at least 5, 5.5 magnitude stars. That's a good couple thousand stars. And you'll notice if you look at the map that they're not confined, although many of them are, in the west and in the desert. Some of them around cities. There are two near Chicago, one near Cleveland. And happily for us, there's one, the closest one, is in New Park State Park in Door County. You can see the lighthouse just off in the distance in the image. That's a place that is guaranteed to have pristine stars. You can go there and then look at your culture in the sky. And I know, too, that in recent years, ecotourism has been a thing. But so too, as a result of the efforts of the IDA and others, is night sky or dark sky tourism. In 2016, I decided to celebrate New Year's Day, in Panama. Now, I will admit that some of it, not a small part, was because it was minus 20 here and it was 95 there. So it's a good trade-off. But mostly, I spent the week in Panama, a country I knew nothing about, and I had a great time. But I spent a week there so that I could see these five stars, the Southern Cross. Since I was a child, I have wanted to see the Southern Cross because I wanted to recapture that night in Detroit when I first saw the stars. And you have to travel to see new stars. You have to travel below or close to the equator. And I remember getting up every morning at 3:30 from my little bungalow and looking out with a cup of coffee and crying every night, as I did the night I first saw Orion for the first time. It's magical. It's wonderful. So does this work? The answer is yes. And you can see this most clearly in a short little video that demonstrates the differences in the night sky using what's called the Bortle scale of sky brightness and light pollution. Before I go, I want to thank you again for coming virtually to this convocation. And I want to think back 8 months ago. At the start of the school year, President Burstein spoke to us of home and the importance of home in times of the pandemic. So it is only fitting and proper that we end the school year talking about our celestial home, our cosmic home, and how we can save, preserve, and protect it, and everything that it represents. So that the next time a 12-year-old girl walks out into the snow and looks at the sky, she doesn't see just dozens of stars. She doesn't just see hundreds of stars. She sees thousands of stars and the limitless possibilities of the future with the generations of her culture and all the cultures that preceded her behind her back. Thank you so much, and don't forget to look up tonight.
Thank you. Ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba